Good afternoon, AUP. Welcome to the session of our week of prayer, Edge.
So, Ate Rachel, the last time we met our brothers and sisters here in PIC was, we dismissed at 9 a.m. this morning, right?
Yes.
So it's already 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, around 7.5 hours ago. And so I just want to ask you, how were you in that 7.5 hour there?
During that 7.5 hours, I admit I felt a little bit stressed, exhausted, and tired because of the activities that we have done for the previous subjects. However, I want to praise the Lord still because I felt really blessed throughout those hours because He has sustained me to survive the activities. Actually, we had an activity in our major subjects wherein we sang a song that was composed by us. It talks about health and how we should maintain good health as we serve the Lord in this ministry. And I can see that there are lots of students who are still willing to come back here in this afternoon session of our week of prayer, because I know that despite of their struggles within the day, they know that God still sustained them. How about you, Michael? How's your day?
Oh, my day today is quite tiring, you know, this afternoon. And since yesterday is quite hot, it's not quite hot, but it's very hot, you know.
Yeah, I felt
sweating.
So too.
And I have an amazing experience also this afternoon. I only have class in the morning, but in the afternoon, I'm free. I was free in that time, the afternoon. But although I was free, the assignment is very faithful waiting for me for the next day. So this afternoon, I spent my time to meet my assignments, and I was hoping that I can finish it by 5:15, but praise God, I can finish it before 5:15, around maybe to something, and this is very amazing. And Ate Rachel, I just want to greet our brothers and sisters here.
Yes.
So, our brothers and sisters in Christ, God is good, and all the time, guys, amen.
It seems that they are a little bit stressed, really stressed and
like
tired
you
throughout the day. So, can we still get more energy from you? So, God is good? And all the time?
Praise God. So, Adresa, this morning, today, the topic was very amazing, you know, about the story when Moses led the Israelites and when they arrived in front of the Red Sea. Like, it's just like an amazing event, you know. It seems like they were there, and when the king Pharaoh chased them, it seems like there is no way for them to go out. But it's God's way. Like, God just make the way like that. In front of them are sea. And the sea were divided into two, and there is a way. And it seems like,
and the land is dry.
Yeah, in our life also. And that story is very inspiring. And Teresa, how about you? How was your experience?
The part that I was touched from the message early this morning is the part where Dr. Shin emphasized how God, or how Jesus Christ, has said to Moses, "Go, don't think about me, just hit or strike the rock. I am willing to die for you." Aside from that, I have realized that we, of course, as human beings, we need water, diba?
Yeah.
We always feel thirsty. I always bring water with me. Yeah, because I always feel thirsty and I feel the need to drink water every day, especially I'm in the College of Health. So, about we really need to take care of our health. And of course, every one of us has to take care of our health. And aside from that, aside from needing that water, we need a water that when we drink from that water, we would never be thirsty again. And that water is only offered by who? Who do you think?
Jesus.
Yeah, that's right. So that water is only offered. We can just get that water from the one who is offering it to us freely, and that is Jesus Christ. And I hope and pray that every one of us here in this university will choose to get or drink from that water which Christ is offering us, because we will know and we will feel that if we drink from that water, we will never feel the thirst again in our spiritual life.
Amen. So, just for a reminder, I have some announcement that we have a united prayer every day from 5 a.m. to 6 a.m. in the morning, and in the afternoon we have 3 p.m. and until 4 p.m. still in the upper room.
And aside from that, this coming Vesper, we have a communion service. Yeah, and so we will be having our communion service this coming Vesper. And aside from having a communion service this Vesper, there is another invitation for us to be a blessing to other people. And that invitation is for us to bring our special offerings for the poor. Yeah. And aside from that, we would like to remind everyone who wants to join the prayer and fasting for tomorrow, you may proceed to the right wing right after our afternoon session.
Okay, so Teresa, this morning we have heard an interesting topic. I just got curious, what is our title?
The title of our topic for this afternoon is Be the Redeemed. You know, Michael, I wonder what the content of the message would be. And so, UP students, may we focus our hearts and our minds to our God, and may we not let the enemy distract us from the temptation that would be a hindrance for us not to hear the beautiful and wonderful message that God wants us to know. And so, let's not make this long. I know that they are also excited to know what would be the message that is about Be the Redeemed. And so, once again, good afternoon, AUP. Welcome to this session of our Week of Prayer Edge.
As we continue to our worship this afternoon, shall we all rise and sing "That Glorious Day Is Coming."
Good afternoon, church. Good afternoon, sons and daughters of living God. It is indeed pleasurable to stand before you today, mostly in this week where we have been so blessed and revived by the Word of God. The focus of our season of prayer for today is our need for the Savior. Once again, our need for the Savior. The sequence will be the same, just as the other days. First of all, the praise team will be singing, and Mom Love will do the introduction prayer, and the congregation will be given 3 minutes to pray by partner or prayers, and so the praising team will be sing again, and Mom Love will be ending the season of prayer. But before that, I would like to invite you to read with me the book of Ellen G. White, Cross Object Lesson, page 162, the first paragraph. Cross Object Lesson, page 162, paragraph 1. It says, "The life with the fear of the Lord is cherished will not be a life of sadness and gloom. It is the absence of Christ that makes the countenance sad. It means that when we don't have Jesus Christ in our life, our countenance will become a sad and a life of a pilgrimage of sight. Those who are filled with self-esteem and self-love do not feel the need of living a personal union with Christ. The heart that has not fallen on the rock is proud of its wholeness Men want a dignified religion. They desire to walk in a path wide enough to take in their own attributes, their self-love, their love of popularity, and the love of praise, exclude the Savior from their hearts. And without him, there is gloom and sadness. For those who doesn't love Jesus Christ in their life, they have a gloom and sadness, but that is the hope. But Christ dwelling in the soul is a wellspring of joy. Amen? For all who receive him, the very keynote of the word of God is rejoice. Please let us kneel for the word of prayer.
I need thee every hour, most precious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Eternal Father in heaven, we would like to lift your name on high, for you are worthy of all glory and honor, praises and adoration. We are here coming before you, Lord, for we recognize our nothingness before you. Father, we recognize that we need you more than we need water, air, or food. Father, many of us came here in this hall walking dead. We are indeed dead spiritually. Some of us just came here for attendance. Some of us just came here for curiosity. But Father, we pray that you will all empty us with self, so that Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, will be able to fill ourselves, our empty vessels. Father God, hear your children as we seek for you in prayer. Hear us, O God. heard our prayers. You have heard the longings of our hearts. Father, we invoke your holy presence to be in our midst. We invite the holy angels to be surrounding us here. And we pray that the enemy will be pounded this afternoon, that he will not be able to cover the ears of the listeners. They will not be able to touch the lips, that everyone will be quiet listening to your words. We also would like to ask your holy presence, Lord, to keep us awake this afternoon, that not a single word that is coming from you will ever be wasted. Father, indeed, we need you. We pray in a very special way for our speaker, Pastor Shin. May you inspire him again this afternoon. May you anoint his lips that he will be speaking your words and your words alone. Father God, we also would like to pray for some of the prayer requests. Others are requesting, Lord, for healing, physical and spiritual healing. We also would like to pray for our computer science department. Father, we do not know exactly what is going on, but you know everything. And so we pray that you will provide the needs of our computer science department. And may you fill us all with spirit. And may we have a different experience this afternoon, that this afternoon's program will not only become an event, but this will change us forever. Thank you so much for hearing and answering our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is an honor and privilege to share my experience with prayer and fasting. I was with my humble desires of seeking and knowing the Lord, I was able to approach by our dean, Ms. Sambim, and asked me if I would like to participate, join to the prayer and fasting. With the Holy Spirit's guidance, I was able to say yes and participate the next day. It was my first time to participate in fasting and pray at the same time. Fasting, it's not just about abstaining yourself with the food, the earthly food, but rather it is emptying yourself and letting God fill you through your prayers. It is with the Holy Spirit, the earnest desire for you to be filled without being fed of the earthly food. Fortunately, I was able to go through the day with the guidance and the spirit, the earnest desire. I didn't even, personally, I did not feel that I was really hungry, but rather I was filled with joy and strength. Towards the end of the day, I felt so connected to the Creator and truly blessed with the message that I'm receiving in the prayer seasons. And I would highly encourage you to participate on tomorrow's prayer and fasting. This is another time that we can actually gather and communicate and commune earnestly with our Father, Heavenly Father. And I pray that each one of you will be touched and be filled, and let yourself be empty, and let God fill you with the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. The living faith that you have right now is God's instrument for you to endure unto the edge, so that when He comes, when Jesus comes, you and me will be in heaven someday. And in that glorious kingdom, one day, all of us, we will lift our voices and all together we sing, glory and honor, worthy is the Lamb. May this song will bless you and prepare you for His soon return.
Good afternoon. I'll be praying for Pastor. As we were praying over there, I felt that the Lord wanted me to share something. I would like to ask everyone here today to please turn off your cell phones. If you have a Bible on your phone and you're going to read the Bible, I would humbly request you that if you could put it on flight mode. And before I pray, I will give 5 seconds for us to do that. Those who came here to hear God's word, your cell phones are still on. I humbly request that you turn them off. And if you have a Bible on your phone, you can put it on flight mode. So I'll give you 5 seconds to do that before we pray. Let's pray. Dear Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for life. We thank you for the numberless blessings. We cannot count them, Father. Thank you for life. Thank you for your word. Amen. Thank you for the angels. Thank you for your presence here today.
Amen.
Father, we have all sinned in thought, in action, intentionally and unintentionally. Yes. We ask for the forgiveness of our sins in yes. Jesus' name.
Amen.
And Father, we claim that forgiveness and we ask for a double portion of your spirit.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for blessing Pastor Joshua Shin, and we thank you for humbling him and speaking through him. We pray that you may not only bless him during the week of prayer, but even after the week of prayer.
Yes.
May you continue to give him strength to stand in these difficult days.
Yes.
And Lord, we pray for us as we hear your word. Some of us today, Father, we need to accept Jesus.
Amen.
We have been distracted throughout the week of prayer. But this time, Lord, we thank you because you are going to speak.
Yes.
We just plead that you may be merciful towards us.
Amen.
And that you strengthen us and encourage us to accept you today as our personal Savior.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, we praise you and we thank you. Amen.
Amen. Good afternoon, my friends. Good afternoon. Wow, this is already Thursday afternoon and we have only one more day tomorrow. I believe tomorrow afternoon we do not have afternoon session, but we will have Vespers meeting. Some of you may go home earlier, so you may miss my last presentation about David's life. So I'd like to encourage you to come for the evening Vespers meeting. Understanding the full life of David. This afternoon, I'd like to start with my information because after the morning session, almost 15 of students approached me for prayer requests and concerns and their issues and personal agendas. So I spent almost like 2 hours with them, and I've been really blessed that I could minister to them. And also, I need your prayer support. I am the director of the 1000mm, whom should manage and also support, train, and guide our young people from different parts of the world, yearly more than 200 missionaries. And as I've told you, we have 9 branches, and soon we'll have 2 more. And we have nearly 600 missionaries are in about 20 countries. So I need to pray for them. That's why I need to pray a lot. Of course, I need your prayer support. This is my Facebook, Pastor Joshua Shin. And this is my email address, Pastor Joshua Shin, PRJOSHSHIN and gmail.com. And this is my personal cell phone, so you can text me. Always put like AUP somebody so that I will recognize you easily. I have about 450 spiritual children way there in Mongolia and China, and of course Hong Kong and Taiwan, Macau, Japan, Korea, America, Malaysia, Philippines, and many other parts of the world. And I want to include your names. If I can know you personally face to face, it will be much better, and I will have a personal encounter with you. And whenever I have time, I can communicate with you through text and also through emails. And in my Facebook, you will get some informations about the 1000mm in the future. I met several of you. You expressed your willingness to join the 1000mm, and I was really glad. And some of you are planning to do, and some of you are praying about that. So may the Lord continue to bless as you grow spiritually in this wonderful school. All right. King David, wonderful fighter and a great musician, and at the same time he was a spirit-filled worshiper. But if you always, you know, glorify his name, all the good merits of his life, we may not understand the deepest parts of his life. Of course, as a human being, he had ups and downs, and we could see in the Bible. Today, I'm going to search about this particular person because he was a simple human being, just like you and me. Although he had a great potential because of his personal time with the Lord, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and spirit-filled when he was anointed, and that spirit-filled state quite long, extended, and sustained. So it was his blessing. But yet he was a human being. But he always tried to look up the heaven where his heavenly Father is. So this man understood the importance of looking up his life. But at the same time, we could see he had a hard time in his life. Instead of looking up with the glorious, you know, future of him, with all the successes, but this time he is really putting his head down, agonizing with great personal burden. I want to tell you something about his life today, related with especially ladies. You know, we are men that are always side part, which is female. Of course, it is the lady's story. There was always a man. So we will look at something about David. This beautiful lady was the eldest daughter of King Saul. And as I've told you, at the age of 15, he already became a national hero by killing the Goliath, the champion of Philistine. You just imagine this young boy being exalted way up there, and even the soldiers and commanders, they just salute. You are the true fighter. You are the true man. You know what? In man's society, especially the gangsters, the powerful martial artists like that, you know, whenever they see the powerful man, higher skill, better than his power, greater than his position, then they just bow down. They just subdue themselves. Somehow that was the story of David. And King Saul really liked this man. But one day he was struggled with the sound from the throne of his own people. Whenever David was sent by King Saul, all the affairs he touched was so successful. So it made all his troops be proud of this young general. And even the government officers were really pleased with this man. Of course, King Saul was very happy to have such a man. You know what? King Saul put him as his presidential guard. Presidential guard. I mean, king's personal guard. The nearest person holding the spear and shield or sword, protecting king. You just imagine king, whom he will choose more than David. So he assigned him to be his personal guard. And at the same time, as you know, that he was a magician. Whenever he was sick, and especially being insane, then he comforted him through beautiful music. So he was the closest person. And Saul, in the beginning, he really loved him. But when the time passed by, wherever he goes, and he got the great victory news, and whenever he returned back to the city, the people, standing ovation and claps and praises to the name of the David. One day he was returning back from the battlefield after he slaughtered many Philistines, their very enemy. And this was the time that all the village people were getting to the street, and they are welcoming this young general, David. And the ladies, they were singing with dancing, and they gladly welcome, and this wonderful, fine-looking young man, strongest man, the best fighter in the nation. And the ladies said, King Saul has slain his thousands, and David, his tens of thousands. And it's being repeated and repeated and repeated. King Saul was ready to welcome him, you know, but as he was listening to the throne, oh, he was uncomfortable. What they are singing? Saul has slain his thousands, and David has his tens of thousands. Then he is speaking to his, what is he good other than the nation? So from that very day, King Saul became very jealous upon this man. You know, this guy, King Saul, although he was once anointed by God and spirit-filled and prophesied, very humble in the beginning, but now, as he became jealous upon this young general, he wants to kill this man without using his finger. So he made a trap. Okay, I will give you a chance to become my son-in-law. You are just a shepherd boy in the countryside. Of course, by killing the Goliath, you became a government officer, but now you will be glorified if you become my daughter's husband. So he promised. Saul said to David, here is my older daughter, Merab. I will give her to you in marriage. Only serve me bravely and fight the battles of the Lord. For Saul said to himself, I will not raise a hand against him. Let the Philistines do that. He made a trap. And he said, okay, this will be good. And he asked him to fight in here and there. He sent him to the fiercest battle, the most difficult area. And he was expecting that David would be killed by enemies. So instead of using my own finger, nobody knows that he will be killed by enemies. The time came, but this King Saul, very cunning individual, he did not keep the promise. Yet, what he did? But when the time came for Merab, Saul's daughter, to be given to David, she was given in marriage to Adriel Mehola. If you are the man, will you be happy with this kind of king? You are now his bodyguard, and you are the officer anointed and appointed by him. And he promised as a king, I will give my eldest daughter to you in marriage. But now he betrayed. That was the life of David. Don't think that David had a pleasant life, from 15, his kingship. No, he had a hard time. Now, again, he is agonizing. Why? This time, King Saul had a second daughter. Oops, sorry. I didn't change this into English, sorry. His second daughter is Michal, M-I-C-H-A-L, Michal. She was a beautiful lady, and the officers noticed that this lady fell in love with David. Because as I've told you, David was ruddy, handsome, very good looking. Plus, he was a powerful man, wonderful fighter, and the musician, very gentle and humble man. So all the ladies, they loved him, especially the second daughter of King Saul, fell in love with David. Then the officer said, King, you gave your first daughter to somebody. So the people, they understood you as a bad king. But now, you see, your second daughter loves David very much. You may use this for another tribe. Oh, so what is that? Okay, now Saul's daughter Michal was in love with David. And when they told Saul about it, he was pleased. I will give her to him, he thought, so that she may be a snare to him and so that the hand of the Philistines may be against him. So Saul said to David, now you have a second opportunity to become my son-in-law. Was he a good man, King Saul? No way. He was such a bad man. He was such a bad man. By the way, this time he requested, if you go to the Philistine and get 100 foreskins of a man, Philistine man, you know what it means? Each individual has only one sexual genital organs, right? Now he's requesting, David, you go to the Philistine and fight against the enemies and kill at least 100 male and cut the genital organ and bring it. Then I will give my second daughter to you. Whew. Can you believe this was the man of God before? He's the king of Israel. But in order to kill his wonderful fighter, national hero, David, Saul made a kind of snare this way. You just imagine how he could fight against 100 soldiers. Definitely he will be killed. Then instead of using his hands, he will get rid of this enemy. But according to the Bible, David went to the Philistines, and he killed 200 people and got all those foreskins and returned back. Here you are. So, the Michal was given to David in a marriage, and she became David's wife. And one time, while he was insane, David was playing the harp for him. And with his furious eyes, he is day and night thinking, how can I get rid of this man? My enemy, because he will get my throne. Instead of my son Jonathan, he may get my throne. So before he's doing, I must kill him. While he was insane, controlled by the evil spirit, because the spirit of the Lord departed from him, this man really became mad and insane. While he was playing the, harp, sometimes close, it was lovely. Then this king slowly getting his own spear. And he's just right there. less than 10 meters distance. And you know, King Saul was a great fighter and better warrior. And he's aiming now, he's throwing the spear with the full speed. But somehow, pen of inspiration said that God helped him to avoid that spear. Not only once, twice, and three times. You just imagine he was playing that, and all of a sudden, shh, whoo, then he ran away. So he ran back to his house, and he didn't know what to do. And Miko said, honey, what's happening? You know what? Your dad is crazy. He threw the spear to me. I was almost killed. Really? No way. My dad is not. No, your dad really did. He's now crazy. He's trying to kill me. Is that true? So what should I do? So he hid him. And early in the morning, as King Saul sent his troop and get this man, Michal, she let down the rope and David was able to avoid. Because of that, what's happening? You look at this. Saul had given his daughter Michal, David's wife, to Paltiel, the son of Lesh, who was from Gobim. Can you believe? King Saul took David's wife and given to another man. David had really hard, tough life, even from his own father-in-law, the king anointed by God. But David, still he was strong. But you know, David had a lot of difficulties because of woman. By the way, one day, David was in this En-Gedi. This is area, Dead Sea and Mediterranean Sea and the Palestine area. And he was in this area, and somebody reported, King Saul, now I saw David and his troops. They were in En-Gedi. Please come and get him. So King Saul brought 3,000 elite soldiers. You need to understand about David. Right after David killed Goliath, he became the national hero. And as I've told you, many special elite soldiers, they respected him as the new rising star. Although he was the youngest, very young, less than 20 years old, but because of the manhood, the martial art, military spirit, they just salute and they swear that, I will be your soldier. And David had the privilege to have 600 elite troops. And later, this group became 288,000 soldiers. David's kingdom, his government became very strong because of this first inner group, elite troops. And especially out of 600 elite troops, he has 30 extraordinary generals. These guys are really fighters, just like David. If you read the Bible, they were the fighters against 80 people, against 100 people. By the way, the three out of another three generals, inner circle, one person killed 800 soldiers. One against 800. You see, that much, David was surrounded by the top quality soldiers. But you have to understand, out of these 30 extraordinary, his inner circle, his inner commanders, there was a man, Uriah. By the way, with these 600 troops in En-Gedi, he was hiding in the cave. But Saul, he did not know. He just got the report that David and his people are there. So he himself, with 3,000 elite troops, he just searched and he was trying to get him. But something happened. They reached En-Gedi, but somehow he felt emotion. So he told his safeguards and everybody, hey, if you please stay here. Well, there is a cave. Okay, I will go inside and, you know, I will do, and I will come out. So said, yes, king, no problem. We'll guard this area. Of course, they never thought that somebody will be inside of the cave. So King Saul, he went in and he did something. And after he finished his work, somehow, maybe because of the hardship whatsoever, he just, then, according to the Bible, he slept, he took little siesta time, nap in the cave. You know what? If you are in the bright side, you cannot see dark side. But if you are in the darkness side, you could see all the lights. You know what there will be. So inside of cave, 600 troops with David, all the good fighters, they're looking at now outside, you know, the soldiers are moving 3,000. If they, you just imagine if they are caught, they are inside of cave. If they put the fire or just waiting outside, they have no hope. But somehow that's why they were in total silence and waiting inside. And all of a sudden King Saul is coming in and took off his robe and sitting down like that. Also, so all of them know what, wow, what's happening? And then after, he just, and he moved a little more, come inside, and then he took off his, what, armors, and his helmet, and his sword, everything, and he was really disarmed, and took a nap. Man, if you are the soldier of David, definitely, this is the great chance. So they talked to David. David, your God is the true God, because he said you will be the next king. What kind of chance you have now? If you just let me, then I will just go and kill him. Then we will get the government. You will become a king. But David said, no. Let me just do it. You just do not follow me. And you know, he moved slowly like this with his sword, one step, and finally reached. King Saul was still snoring and sleeping. David had the great chance to kill him by just only one pierce. But instead, what David did, he just took this out, and with his knife, he just cut off the edge of the robe. And then he again moved back slowly. And all of his troops said, are you crazy? This is the chance, you should kill him. No, don't talk about it. Then about 30 minutes, I don't know how long, but you know, king, okay. And he came out. And with 3,000 soldiers, and they moved out. And they're there quite far away. Now, then he's saying, Father, Father, King Saul. Yes, he was real father. Why? Because he was the son-in-law before. And King Saul and all the troops, you know, they returned back. What's happening? And there, in front of the cave where he slept and did something, and now there is David and all the troops. And they're saying, well, I took a piece of his robe and I felt that I should. Oh, no, this is what he said to his soldiers. But you know, he said, Father, why you are searching me, trying to kill me? I have done nothing wrong. This is the evidence that I could show you. I have nothing wrong. He said, in the cave, some urged me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not lift my hand against my master because he is the Lord's anointed. because he is the Lord's anointed. I already told you, naturally as a human being, being betrayed not only one time but two times, the Merab and the Michal, two daughters of the king Saul, he somehow publicly announced and what promised with him. But first one was given to another man, and the second one became his wife, but now she is sleeping with someone else. You just imagine the pain and the betrayal, the feeling of betrayal against his own father-in-law. He has a natural reason, human reason, to kill him. Nobody will blame him. But now he said, no, I cannot do. I won't do it because he is simply the Lord's anointed. This morning I want to tell you, some of your leaders could be doing some ugly things, different from you guys. You would see their mischiefs and their misbehaviors and some even wrong things, maybe even immoral things. But if they are anointed by God, do not simply stretch out your hands and try to harm them. I want you to learn this David spirit. Because he was anointed by God, King Saul was anointed by God, if these two individuals anointed by God and fighting each other and kill each other, how you can represent the love of Christ, the love of God? You are anointed by God, he's anointed by God, and you are now trying to kill each other. This is not the way. This is not true image of God. That's why, although his life was miserable, always chased by this insane king, and you have to flee yourself to the desert and to the forest and to even foreign lands, but David was bearing all those pains. I'm okay. But God will judge him. I will let God judge him. You and I, we need to learn this spirit. But anyway, after that, now he has another trial. He was in the desert of Zip. And this time again, his presence was noticed and his presence was reported to the king Saul. This time again, King Saul came, and he was searching all the desert area. But already David noticed his coming, so he hid himself another way. And now there are, you know, all the 3,000 soldiers of Saul, now they are sleeping. In the night, David, as I read this Bible, I really thought that he was a really brave man. You just imagine 3,000 soldiers. But David was bringing only one guard. Only two of them in the night, they go into the depth of this camp. To the very center, circled by many, many hundreds and 3,000 soldiers. David was sleeping in the middle of the camp, and carried by another several bodyguards, the generals, and he was sleeping. Again, this time, David had chance to kill him. The Abishai, who was the follower of David at that night, he said, Lord, just let me pierce him. One time is enough. Just let him kill him. But David said, no, no. He is God's, the Lord's anointed. We should not touch his life. Let us just get his water jar and the spear. So he saved his life again and he moved out. And now he's saying, no, do not kill Saul. Anyone who hurts the Lord's chosen king must be punished. This was his understanding toward God's anointed. As surely as the Lord lives, the Lord himself will punish Saul. Just pick up the spear and the water jug by Saul's head and let's go. After he took these two things and he moved out. And now again, the dawn and the morning rise, and now the soldiers there, they're waking up, and there, far distance, again, David is telling to them, King Saul, why you are chasing me and looking after me? Although God has given me another chance, but I wouldn't harm. And he said, today I showed you that your life is important to me, and in the same way the Lord will show that my life is important to him. He will save me from every trouble. Again, David saved his king's life, not killing, but forgiving. You see, David was a really great man. But when the time goes by, one time he became relaxed. And I'm telling you about his life. You know what? According to the Bible, he had many wives. 15 through 30. Within that 15 years of life, he got at least 6 wives. And from 6 wives, he got 6 sons. I believe he had more, but in the Bible, only 6 sons were recorded, one from each wife. And he became the king in Judah for 7.5 years. And those sons, the princes, came out of these 6. And then after he became the unified kingdom king for 33 years. So all in all, he reigned the Israel for 40 years. And now this time, he had another wife, and he got 4 sons. And from another wife, he got 9 more sons. So according to the Bible, at least he got 19 sons and 1 daughter, Tamar. Of course, we believe there are more daughters, but because of a particular incident, Tamar's name was written in the Bible. He has many, many official wives and concubines. Of course, if you have many branches, the tree has more winds and strong strugglings, swings, and more problems. And now, because of this, one time he was trapped. You look at this man. He's now staring at something from the top of the building, because King's Palace is high, way above than any other buildings. And he's looking down, a beautiful woman taking a bath. We know the story, King David and Bathsheba. Now, as I've told you, he had 600 elite troops and 30 extraordinary generals. You know, the Bathsheba was the wife of one of his 30 generals. He was by the name of Uriah the Hittite. In other words, David had long years of companionship with this particular guy. Out of many hundred, this especially 30 inner circle leaders were always having dined together and meetings together. I personally believe David had known Uriah and his wife many times. And according to the Bible, the pen of inspiration, you see here, amid the perils of his earlier life, David in conscious integrity could trust his case with God. The Lord's hand had guided him safely past the unnumbered snares that had been laid for his feet. But now, guilty and unrepentant, he did not ask help and guidance from heaven, but sought to extricate himself from the dangers in which sin had involved him. Bathsheba, whose fatal beauty had proved a snare to the king, was the wife of Uriah the Hittite, one of David's bravest and the most faithful officers. You just imagine. He was betrayed by his own father-in-law. And he learned these human affairs. And now he's doing exactly the same thing to his lawyer servant. Before the conclusion of the war with the Ammonite, David, leaving the conduct of the army to Joab, returned to Jerusalem. The Syrians had already submitted to Israel, and the complete overthrow of the Ammonites appeared certain. David was surrounded by the fruits of victory and the honors of his wise and able rule. It was now, while he was at ease and unguarded, that the tempter seized the opportunity to occupy his mind. When in ease and self-security, he let go his hold upon God, David yielded to Satan and brought upon his soul the stain of guilt. Man, yesterday we learned we have ups and downs in the condition of Mara, in the condition of Elam, in the condition of Rephidim, all three water issues. Mara, you have water, but because of bitterness, you could not eat, drink. Elam, you have plenty of what? Water. Your life is successful. Rephidim, you have no water at all. You are now even ready to against the Lord. You have ups and downs. Now David is experiencing in his high life, all the success he got, victories over the countries, and now his kingdom become much stronger. So now this time, okay, you go, and I will be resting in my palace. And this was the time the tempter David come and snatched him. And his heart was occupied by evil spirit as he go along on the top of his, and he was looking at somebody's taking a bath, so beautiful. And he was taking her. My friends, after this, as you know that, he's the bravest and the most loyal soldier was killed by the conspiracy he made with Joab. He put him into the first battle line, and he was killed. And naturally, this lady became his wife. But it was because of the conception, she was pregnant. So, the man of God by the name of Nathan requested by God to visit King David. And he told the story to King David. I want you to read this. And as you read this, somehow you will get the idea. Are you ready? Ready, go. There were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. Nathan was a man of God, very wise man, and giving this story to the king. As King David was listening, What kind of man is he, our countryman in my kingdom? Oh my goodness. Surely the Lord is living. I swear I'm the king. Bring him to me, I will kill him. Then the Nathan was looking at him, and he's telling, what? You are the man. You are the man. You have many wives. You have many concubines. You have many sons and many daughters. You have palace. You have everything. But now you are taking your lawyer, bravest man's wife. That is not right. You are the man who did that wrong thing. As you said, you kill yourself. No, Nathan didn't say that. Man, if you are the king, you have power. Will you be happy to listen to that kind of judgmental or commanding words from man of God? King Saul was a different man. When, you know, Prophet Samuel visited him and telling about his mistakes, he was always excusing, no, 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 because of this I did. Please bless me. Please do not leave me. You just think of many people. They are looking at me. Please bless me before they go. He was always trying to be disguised, wrapped, exaggerated. But somehow this man of God, David, was different. He became honest. Then what he said, yes, I have sinned against the Lord. I have sinned against the Lord. The prophet's rebuke touched the heart of David. Conscience was aroused. His guilt appeared in all its enormity. His soul was bowed in penitence before God. With trembling lips, he said, I have sinned against the Lord. All wrong done, the others reaches back from the injured one to God. David had committed a grievous sin toward both Uriah and Bathsheba, and he keenly felt this, but infinitely greater was his sin against God. But God was really forgiving God. Now, though there would be a found none in Israel to execute the sentence of death upon the anointed of the Lord, David trembled, lest guilty and unforgiven, he should be cut down by the swift judgment of God. But the message was sent to him by the prophet, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Yet justice must be maintained. The sentence of death was transferred from David to the child of his sin. Thus the king was given opportunity for repentance, while to him the suffering and the death of the child as a part of his punishment was far more bitter than his own death could have been. You just imagine. He should be killed. He should be judged by God and sentenced to death. But he was forgiven. Yet the consequence of his great sin was transferred, moved from him to this innocent child. So what's happening? Now David is praying. Now, you look at this David. He laid down his king's crown, and he is now crying. And little baby, the Bathsheba, they are crying. Now the pen of inspiration wrote like this. When his child was stricken, David, with fasting and deep humiliation, pleaded for its life. He put off his royal robes, he laid aside his crown, and night after night he lay upon the earth in heartbroken grief, interceding for the innocent one suffering for his guilt. Often when judgment had been pronounced upon persons or cities, humiliation and repentance had turned aside the blow, and the ever merciful, swift pardon had sent messengers of peace. Encouraged by this thought, David persevered in his supplication, so long as the child was spared. Man, now truly David understood the weight of his sin against his loyal servant and this lady. This innocent baby was finally killed. My friends, there are seven penitential psalms by the hands of King David. These are the seven chapters in Psalms 6, 32, 38, 51, 102, 130, and 143. These seven chapters are well known as the penitential poems by the hands of King David. Especially chapter 51, this yellow line, that is the poem that King David wrote right after he was appointed by the Nathan, prophet of God, and as he fully repented his sin, and he wrote this poem. This afternoon, I want to urge you. Now, we are going to read this poem together. With the same heart, the guilty heart, unforgiven yet by the Lord. But as we utter the same poem by the hands of the King David, who knows, maybe tonight, if you and I had any iniquities and transgressions against the law of God and law of the school, law of our human beings, if you have hated somebody, if you immorally, you know, purchased somebody in your heart, and you have done some of the wrong things against God and against the people, I'd like to invite you to read this with genuine heart. Are you ready to read? I hope we will be reading all together, like David is uttering his prayer to the Lord. Okay, ready, go. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts you will make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Read, continue. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressor your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, all else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifice of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. Do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you shall be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offering. Then they shall offer bulls on your altar. My friends, I'm imagining the nights and days he was crying with his pillows. In the night on the bed, he cried and cried. Day and night for many, many days. Yes, in the story, he was the richest man with many flocks and herds. He was plentiful, but yet he did not use his one of his fingers, but he wanted to use someone else. That's why he got another lawyer servant's wife. Man, you and I are exactly the same with David. I'm guilty. I'm a sinner, as you are. So this evening, I would like you to ponder the spiritual message through the song. And I hope you will understand the love of God. And I truly hope, as you listen to the songs, if some of you, you feel that I really need Jesus Christ tonight. And I truly hope that He will be coming into my heart and become righteous Lamb of God on the top of my head. As we learn the word I in Korean language, righteousness. I am a sinner, but if the Lamb of God is upon myself, from the top of the heaven when God is looking down on my part, we will be covered by His righteousness. And he will be justified and forgiven. This evening, I'm inviting you to the very special moment. You and I are the children of God. We have to know that we have Father, not only earthly Father, but our heavenly Father. And just like a King David, we could have very successful life once we truly linked with our God. We could do some mistakes just as King Saul and especially David did. But once we truly confess our sins and come to the throne of grace and forgiveness, He's ever merciful, ever loving, ever forgiving, ever generous, slow to anger, and He's ready to forgive us. Once you and I realize that I am a sinner, I need Jesus. And that's the moment God is opening His heart and He's embracing us. So this evening, as we listen to the final opening song, I want you to stand, especially tonight, if you feel that I need Jesus as my personal Savior. Just like this song, I am a sinner. I am a sinner. Then please stand and come forth. I want you to stand if you'd like to be just like David, forgiven by the Lord. And if you want to commit your life to the Lord, Lord's great work, His world mission, and His wonderful, glorious work, I'd like to invite you to stand. And now, if you really feel that I need Jesus, you have heard already how many sermons, but I truly need Jesus, then I want you to be encouraged to come forward. I will go down now and I will be waiting for you. And I want to bless you tonight, especially for the person who will come in for the baptism. This coming Sabbath, we are going to have baptism ceremony. And I already know that many of you already have made the decision to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So as you listen to the song, and I want you to be encouraged, if you are a little shy, then you come with your friends, no problem. I'll be waiting for you here.
Lord, reveal to us the signs of love is coming. There'll be false Christ wars and famines, earthquakes and pestilence.
Yes.
Many will be persecuted, hated and betrayed. From this we will know that is coming, is at the edge. Keep watch, be not deceived.
My friends, don't be afraid. My dear friends, you are witnessing this night. I believe more than 100 young people, they're giving their lives to the Lord. Maybe some of them already got baptized, but many of them, I believe, they are accepting Jesus as their personal Savior. What a wonderful steps you made. Truly, you are blessed. What you have chosen tonight is the greatest choice you made in your lifetime. Nothing else, your degree, your premise, you know, wonderful school and job whatsoever, that we may give little short time of joy and happiness on earth. But this choice tonight, accepting Jesus as your personal Savior, that is the greatest and the most wonderful decision you made. Praise the Lord that God has given such tender heart in your heart. Now we will pray for this wonderful congregation. You made your photographer come and you take this wonderful, wonderful scenery. You just look at this beautiful picture. I'm so much overwhelmed. I preached here and there, you know, like 190 students coming out of Taipo Samyuk in Hong Kong, but I truly blessed. May the Lord bless you all, AUP, and beloved children of God. Let me pray. Loving Heavenly Father, Tonight you are standing as our Lord and Savior, our loving Father in heaven. What a wonderful privilege we can be the heirs of God, kingdom of heaven. Thank you for lifting our lives, our own identity from earthly man to heavenly being, from sinner to the righteous, holy person of God. Yes, Lord, tonight we understood the love of Christ even toward that sinner David. Although he was really potentially great and did wonderful things, yet he was a sinful man and simple sinner. But once he was fully repented and confessed his sins, you graciously offered your forgiveness and you accepted and embraced him again back to the bosom of love. This evening, Lord, now we are gathering in front of this pulpit. More than 100 young people, they are coming out of their steps, which was the great choice they made on earth. And I truly believe the angelic host and Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, I know you are giving your smiles and you are opening your arms and you already embrace them, oh Father. I thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful time. Father, now I bless them as they continue to have steps of life with you, Lord. Please give them powerful journey with you. They may fall again down to the ground, but the Holy Spirit come closer to them, raise them again and again, because the righteous will stand firm again. Father, we are living in the edge time of the earthly history. And as we are hearing again and again, good and faithful to the edge of the earth will be saved. Father God, I do not know their personal name, but Lord, I know you are writing their names on the book of life this moment. And the angels and the heavenly beings will be greatly pleasant. Father, thank you so much for this wonderful night. Let us continually remember this wonderful moment we made, and please allow us to enjoy the redemption of salvation, eternal life in Christ. Let our life in this school and the rest of our lives be pleasant, peaceful, and enjoyable to many people and especially to ourselves. May God bless this wonderful throne and all the congregation, faculties, and students, now and forever. This is my humble prayer tonight for all of us in this very room. By the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, all the congregation say, Amen. Amen.
To those who are willing to be baptized, we're requesting you to please proceed to the left side of PSC and occupy row A and B that is near the mother's room. Again, to those who are willing to be baptized, we're requesting you to stay and occupy the row A and B of PIC. And to those who are willing to join the prayer and fasting, we're requesting you to please proceed to the right wing. Thank you very much.
Excuse me. Okay, as you go out, some of you made a decision to be baptized. I'd like to encourage you to remain here. Where, Ronald? Just here. Okay. The front seat area, those who are going to be baptized, please